Our second and last speaker for today is your quintessential journalist, who has maintained his highest credibility in this age of fake news. And he's affiliated with BBC World News, where he anchors Newsday and the Asia Business Report, aired to more than 400 million households worldwide. He is the first ever Filipino news anchor to work for two of the world's most prestigious television news networks, CNBC Asia and BBC World News. A recipient of the Outstanding Young Man for Broadcast Journalism, he has co-presented Newsday, a news program on the BBC Singapore. To speak on the power of media and can good news change public opinion, it is my pleasure and honor to present to you one of the most insightful journalists from Asia and the world, Rico Hizon. Wow. I am live in Cebu. From the Waterfront Hotel for the District, Rotary District 3860 District Conference 2017. I've never spoken to so many people under one roof before. I've spoken to a camera that broadcasts to 450 million people around the world, but now I'm getting butterflies in my stomach because I see close to 1,000 delegates just looking at me and wondering what this person will be talking about. Is it fake news? Is it alternative facts? Or is it real, balanced, credible, unadulterated news? So what do you want? Fake news? Alternative facts? Or do you want Rico Hizon reporting for BBC World News? Wow. First and foremost, I would like to thank Rotary District 3860 for inviting me to beautiful Cebu. It is indeed an honor to be here with all of you this afternoon. As they say, maayong apon sa inyong tanan. Wow, that took me 5 hours to practice. Kamusta kamong tanan? I'm fine too. First and foremost, I would like to acknowledge the Rotary International President's Representative, Robert Wall, and his spouse, Charlene. Welcome to the Philippines, because it's more fun in the Philippines. And I would also like to acknowledge the District Convention Chairman, Conrado Aberintos. Well, of course, I met earlier, the host club, Rotary Club of Cebu Puente President, Mary Christine Tio. Thank you for having me. The past Rotary International Director, Guillermo Tumangan, and his spouse, Letty. Hello, sir, how are you? And the District Governor-elect, Art Tan. And most especially, this one person who I met 4 years ago when I gave a talk here at the Cebu Chamber of Commerce told me, Rico, please mark your calendar, March 2017, because I wanted to come to Cebu to be one of the keynote speakers. And I told her, are you sure? Do you want to invite me 3 years in advance? She is indeed a long-term planner, and I would like to thank her for bringing me here to Cebu, the District Governor for District 3860, Mary Ann Alcordo Solomon. Thank you very much. And of course, Tito, maraming maraming salamat. Is everyone okay this afternoon? I'm sure half of you here are wondering, who is this Rico Hizon? I've never seen him on television.
Have you seen me on BBC World News?
Yes.
That's good. That means we have an audience here in Cebu. Because of course, before I was part of the local news. I was in GMA 7 about 29 years ago. That's how old I am, and that's how long I've been in the broadcasting industry. I started out as a reporter. No, let me backtrack. I started out as a tagadimpla ng kape. I started out as a production assistant at GMA News, making coffee for Tina Monzon Palma, Dong Puno, and Vicky Morales. That's how I started. And then, I wanted to become a reporter. I wanted to become a news anchor. So, I worked, I persevered, and eventually I became a news anchor for GMA 7. After that, 7 years at GMA, I joined one of the largest international business news organizations, CNBC, and that was for 7 years. And then after that, I've been with BBC World News now for the past 14 years. Just to give you some background of what I've done. So I've been out of the country now for the past 21 years of my broadcasting career. Everyone asks me, why did I decide to join international news? Because I want to make every Filipino proud. I wanted to be a trailblazer for every Filipino. And I wanted to prove to everyone that a Filipino can become an international news anchor. And whenever I sit on my anchor's chair, broadcasting to 400 million people around the world, I am always proud to be a Filipino. I'm raising my flag every time I'm on that seat, saying that I am a Filipino. Everyone asks me, where were you educated? In the UK, in the US, in Australia? I said, none of the above. I was educated in a country which has the best English speakers in Asia, and that is the Philippines. So, let's cut all the bureaucracy here of me talking about myself. And let me now talk about this topic which was given to me by Mean, which is the power of media can good news change public opinion. So let me start off, Rotary Club members, with a positive achievement that caught my attention about 14 months ago. It was December 1st, 2015. The Filipino people and the people of the world woke up to one of the most astonishing news reports anyone can imagine. This company in the Philippines called Emperador, owned by Filipino tycoon Andrew Tan, acquired Spain's fundador Pedro Domecq. It was an all-cash deal which was worth 275 million euros. That is a lot of money, and when you multiply that into pesos, that is more than 13 billion pesos. That was a major amount of money invested in an international brand by any Filipino company. Fundador, in case you did not know, is Spain's largest and oldest brandy and one of the most prestigious brands in the world. On that day, the Philippine flag was raised on this property in Spain and has been flying ever so proudly since. And for avid followers of Philippine media, this event marked a rare occurrence. Why was it a rare occurrence? Because all the broadsheets carried the story on the front pages instead of the business sections. Because most of the business stories that happen here in the Philippines, success stories, usually end up in page 20, 25, or 30, or in the second or third supplement, but never on the front page. Not only that, major international publications from the Wall Street Journal, the Financial Times, to the international networks such as BBC World News, CNN, Bloomberg, and CNBC, carried this major business story. So you had what? Large photographs of Andrew Tan inspecting and signing brandy casks graced the upper fold of the papers. You know what? Nobody really reads the papers anymore. If they do read the papers, it's usually only the upper half of the fold. And if you are on a digital publication, you just read maybe the first half or three-fourths of the page of the digital newspaper. So the upper fold, let me explain to you, is very prime location. And everyone knows that. It is the first thing we see when we look at a physical newspaper. And in this digital age, it is the only section most people get to see. It was also among the top stories in the teasers being aired during commercial breaks during the broadcast. As we all know, when we watch our local news, it's never business news, but it's other stories that basically from extrajudicial killings to political extravaganzas to things that happen on a day-to-day basis in our country. So in a sea of stories depicting violent crimes and scandalous corruption charges, it was the only good news on the front page. The story triumphed on local media was a result of a confluence of events. In poetic terms, it was a moment when all the stars were aligned, and they were. The story was of global significance. What do I mean by global significance? It was both global and local. It had that David and Goliath quality, with a company from a third world Asian country taking over a cherished European brand. Adding more color and spice to the story was the fact that the Philippines was a former colony of Spain, further bringing forth the imagery of the underdog overcoming all obstacles to claim success over a global power. Back then, many international economists began to view the Philippines in a very positive light. Our credit ratings, I'm sure most of you here are entrepreneurs or businessmen, improved over the past 6 years. The outlook on the economy was upbeat and investments were on the rise. But most people still could not feel the positive effects of an improving economy. So Emperador's acquisition of Fundador served as a concrete example that drove this point home. A Filipino company now owns Fundador. What could be more inspiring than that? The story was triumphant. It was inspirational. It was a front page material that could push the latest bribery scam down to the lower fold of the newspaper. Unfortunately, such alignment of the stars within a Filipino business story or a success story or a positive development does not come very frequent in Philippine media. It happens very rarely. That's why I cited this as an example. So if you take out your wonderful high-tech smartphones right now and click on your Facebook application or on your Twitter or on your Instagram, your newsfeed is likely to be overflowing with negativity. You have these kinds of issues that you see on your Facebook newsfeed: scandals, corruption, extrajudicial killings, natural disasters, fake news, alternative facts. Even the recent glamorous Oscars was marked by a wrong announcement in the Best Picture category. Something that we all Filipinos are familiar with, especially with what happened in the 2016 Miss Universe Beauty Pageant when the winner was Miss, supposedly Miss Philippines, but what was announced was Miss Colombia. So that is what basically excites a lot of readers now. So unless it's Miss Universe or the Olympics, it is almost impossible to find good news on the front pages. Do you agree with me? Do you agree with me that we don't see much of the good news on our front pages?
Yes.
But to say that this is because bad news sells is an oversimplification of the issue, and it is unfair to media. Because we need journalists to analyze issues, to question dubious policies, to investigate corrupt practices, to shed light when answers are vague, and to expose those responsible for wrongdoings. As a journalist myself for the past 29 years, I know how many man hours it takes to put together an analytical piece that traces the murky history of a scandal, offer documentary evidence of wrongdoing, and identify the officials behind it. Most stories, especially the investigative ones, take months to write. Some take years of chasing leads and reading thousands of pages of documents. When it all comes together, the results are explosive and its impact reverberates throughout all levels of society. It is urgent and it needs to rouse the readers to demand accountability, and it needs to be on the front page. Yes, you're right. Bad news sells. But the decision to put these stories on violence and corruption on the front page is driven by the editor's determination of what issues the public urgently needs to know, and hopefully put pressure on the authorities to address them. As a so-called fourth estate, which is the people and organizations that report the news, we take our responsibilities very, very seriously to keep the government transparent and accountable to the public. And the front page remains one of our most powerful tools. But too much bad news can be bad news as well. For a country that has been recognized over the last 6 years as an economic miracle in Asia, our media outlets seem to have an underwhelming amount of news to support the observation and outlook of international economic experts. So, my question is to you, is there a shortage of good news to report? Veteran journalist Vergel Santos once said that there is no such thing as good news or bad news. There is only news. Whatever is good or bad depends on how it impacts or affects a person, and or which side of the issue you belong to, or which issue you are biased for. So, let me cite you an example. The recent Miss Universe result, was it bad news? For some, yes. For the Philippines and for the 85 other countries, because we did not win the Miss Universe pageant. We didn't win it back to back. But it was good news for France, where the winner, Iris Mitterrand, comes from. What about the current peso-dollar exchange rate? I'm sure many of you here are importers and exporters. It is favorable to exporters, but the opposite is true for importers. While I do agree that news should have no color, I also believe that there are stories that evoke feelings of mourning or celebration. Scams, scandals, violence, natural disasters make up the former. And goodness knows, the Philippines experiences a disproportional number of that on a daily basis. But the latter, reasons to celebrate seem few, and far between. One thing I have discovered as a journalist is that the triumph of the human spirit is an inexhaustible source of stories worth celebrating. And the 7,107 islands we know as the Philippines are filled with triumphant spirits. So many typhoons batter the country every year, yet we never fail to pick up ourselves and rebuild from such overwhelming tragedy again and again. It's a testament to that. And as Bernard, you mentioned earlier, we Filipinos are resilient. We are hardworking. We persevere. And we have this very important trait of bayanihan. There is always that teamwork. When the Filipino has fallen, we will rise once again with each other's help. So going back to my earlier question, is there a shortage of good or positive news? No, there is not. Here in Cebu alone, your very own, Bernie Liu of Pensha, has been a steady source of positive news. Apart from attracting international superstars for endorsers, including Cameron Dallas, Gigi Hadid, Sandara Park, Cara Delevingne, Mauro Maurer, Kendall Jenner, and hopefully Rico Hizon in the future. Just kidding. You also have the popular fashion brand expanding its operations globally with stores in Indonesia, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, and Cambodia. You also have a furniture designer, Kenneth Coponque, who has put Cebu and the Philippines on the radar of luxury taste makers and investors. His designs have been recognized by prestigious award-giving bodies, and his furniture has graced many Hollywood films and TV series. His chairs at the APEC Leaders Summit in 2015 are still being talked about today. We have so many superstars here in the Philippines who have made it overseas. You have our Miss Universe, Pia Wurzbach. You have Lea Salonga, Arnel Pineda, Apple Diap, and of course, our 8-time world boxing champion, Manny Pacquiao. They are Filipino prides. But you know what? I shouldn't be looking so far afield for success and positive stories. Because you know what? Right here in this ballroom of close to 1,000 delegates, you and the person beside you are good news and successful stories. You are part of Rotary 3860 because you have made it. You are successful in your own right. You have contributed a big part to Philippine nation building. Let's give each other a big round of applause. Just looking through this brochure has really made me proud to be part of this Rotary District Conference 2017, because there are over 50 projects in this brochure that the Rotary Club 3860 has accomplished for your communities. So this in itself is good news and positive news that has to be told, not only in this brochure, but to every Filipino and to every person around the world, because you have accomplished so much for your own people and for the Philippines. Let's give each other a big round of applause. I'm really proud. And you know what? We always come up with economic data. I always report 6.8% growth for the Philippines in 2016. Sometimes I just get the numbers. But you are why the Philippines has been able to attain one of the fastest growing economies in Asia. Even faster economic growth than China. We are now only second to India, but around the world, but look at India, there are more than a billion people. We are 100 people, and we have been able to attain 6.8% economic expansion. And that is a major accomplishment. And now, when I used to report on the Philippines, when I started with the BBC, we were never noticed. We were never noticed as a rising star of Asia and the Pacific. And now, we are always on the front pages of international publications because we have the people, we have the resources that has made our country grow year after year after year. And we're all hoping that this will continue for many years to come. Because once we grow on a consistent basis between 6 to 8%, then we can catch up with the likes of China, with the likes of Japan, the likes of Korea in terms of economic expansion and per capita GDP. We have really cemented our place as one of the fastest growing among the emerging markets in the world. So despite uncertainties in the global economic landscape, we are expected to continue along with this growth trajectory. Domestic consumption is strong. The outsourcing and tourism sectors are solid. And remittances from overseas Filipino heroes continue to pour in to the tune of $29 billion in 2016. You know, ladies and gentlemen, I can go on and on listing one amazing story after another, but I think you all get the picture. We have a lot. We have an oversupply of positive and good news. We have reason to celebrate. Unfortunately, these stories lack the confluence of events, that elusive alignment of stars that would catapult them to the upper fold of the front page. There is no sense of urgency to report success. And that should be one of our main advocacies, to really put good news on the top half of our major publications, not the bottom half of the front page, and not on page 10, page 20, 30, or 40. It should be on the front page, because if this happens, this will really inspire a lot of Filipinos. And many Filipinos will also aspire to be successful as the Filipinos who have already succeeded. While I'm a journalist by profession, I also have a passionate interest in the arts. And years of appreciating artworks, interacting with artists, and studying their techniques has taught me the concept of negative space, which I think best explains the good, positive, and the bad and the negative news dilemma. When painters look at their blank canvas and conceptualize what to paint, they make a careful consideration of the elements to include. They agonize over every flower, tree, leaf, figure, glass, or even a fruit that they choose to depict on their canvas. But what drives them to greater agony are the elements that they choose to leave out and the spaces that they choose to leave blank. What they choose not to put on the canvas speaks volumes of the kind of artist that they are. as much as the elements that they paint on. And this combination of positive and negative spaces work together to create the whole picture, which is the expression of the inner being. The positive news that we leave out speaks volume of the kind of people we are becoming, as much as the negative news that we have chosen to highlight. Let me repeat that. The positive news that we leave out speaks volumes of the kind of people we are becoming, as much as the negative news we have chosen to highlight. Well, that may seem so profound. And because art imitates life, the life imitates art. Finding that balance, that aspect of art in life that we are all trying to achieve, will make a difference in how we view our world and how the view and how the world views us. It is not about sweeping the negative news under the rug. It is important, it is also necessary, because it keeps us in check. But it is important to recognize the value of positive news as well, because it sparks hope. It sparks creativity and reproduces more positivity. The author Marianne Williamson said, "It is adequately, as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. When we learn of other people's success, just like Bernie here, Kenneth, and all the other successful businessmen and entrepreneurs in this ballroom, we are inspired to achieve the same. When we share the story of success, we give hope to others to achieve the same." Clearly, ladies and gentlemen, news, whether good or bad, positive or negative, is immensely powerful. For better or for worse, accurate and relevant information can change the world. But the goal is not to shape public opinion. As journalists, as I have been for close to 3 decades, it is not our place to sway and influence people's minds one way or another. The goal has been and will always be to deliver complete, accurate, and relevant information in a timely fashion that could move people to action. The stories reporting violence and oppression should enrage us and make us stand up, speak out, and demand its end. And in the same vein, stories of triumphs and positive action should inspire us, move us, and make us work harder to achieve success for ourselves and for others. Likewise, it is the duty of the public to receive this information, study it, analyze it, and make an informed opinion on issues based on correct information and a logical assessment of the situation. So, delegates, friends, at this point, I hope after my talk this afternoon to all of you, you will share the good news. Do not just read your news feed and just keep on sharing. You have to read the content. You have to analyze it. And tell yourselves, is this real news? Is this fake news? Is this just alternative facts? We have to think. We cannot just be, you know, just readers of the news without understanding and imbibing what the issues are. We have to make the right decisions. I mean, you know, it's so easy. Just one click on your phone, you share it. And then it shares multiple, it multiplies. And then what? Everyone will get back to you. Lita, Rico, man, you shared fake news. would you like to be part of that? No, you wouldn't want to be part of that world. You want to inspire people. You want people to read what is positive and what is good. The good in the Filipino, the beauty of the Philippines is what we should share to our friends and to our Facebook friends, to our Facebook followers on social media. So before I end my talk, I'd like to tell everybody that there is really no room for alternative facts. And there is no room for fake news. There is only truth and a conscious choice to be illuminated by its light. Maraming salamat po. Mabuhay ang Rotary District 3816. Mabuhay ang Cebu. Thank you very much.
May I request our second and last speaker on the conference stage, Mr. Rico Hizon, sir. Please receive your token of appreciation again. Rotary District 3860 All-Star Team Award is presented to the future bench-up endorser, Rico Hizon, for being a role model and serving humanity as a strong advocate for responsible broadcast journalism. Welcome.
Again, Rico Hizon, our champion for responsible broadcast journalism.